Just this past year, a team of our favorite writers wrote a brand new hymn for the Collinsworth family. And we are so honored for all 50 states of the U.S. and all 10 provinces of Canada to take this message everywhere we go. The Lamb of God is alive.
Crucified across the nails, he church tonight. Go ahead and take your light blue hymnal. And before we begin, I'm going to ask Brother Peter if you'll ask God to bless our services tonight. Peter, if you'll pray and ask God to bless our services. Yes, sir. Amen. Amen. Thank you very much. Light Blue Hymnal, song number 399. I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day, higher ground. I think everybody just about knows this one. 399. You ready? Here we go. I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher. My heart has no desire to stray where doubts arise and fears. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world. For faith has caught the joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I'll pray till heaven I've found. Lord, lead me on to higher. Lord, lift me up. It's good. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Then we're going to sing His Mercy Is More. So I'll start playing this a little bit. I'll get to remembering it. Okay, we'll struggle through it. How many remember this tune and this? All right, here, let's go. What love could remember no wrongs we have done? Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore, our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins are many, His mercy is more. Sins, they are many, patiently wait. Keep going. Since your many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins are many, his mercy is more. What riches of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Amen. Oh, he is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Amen. Now in the light blue again, 333. His way with thee.
Would you live for Jesus and be always pure and good? Would you walk with him within the narrow road? Would you have him bear your burden, carry all your load? Let him have his way with thee. His power can make you what you ought to be. His blood can cleanse your heart and make you free. His love can fill your soul and you will see. 'Twas best for him to have his way with thee. Would you have him make you free and follow at his call? Would you know the peace that comes by giving all? Would you have him save you so that you need never fall? Let him have his way with thee. His power can make you what you ought to be. His blood can cleanse your heart and make you free. His love can fill your soul and you will see. 'Twas best for him to have his way with thee. Would you in his kingdom find a place of constant rest? Would you prove him true in providential test? Would you in his service labor always at your best? Let him have his way with thee. His power can make you what you ought to be. His blood can cleanse your soul and make you free. His love can fill your soul and you will see. 'Twas best for him to have his way with thee.
Then our last song tonight is going to be Speak, O Lord. So take out that piece of paper in front of you. Should be in there by the songbook, Speak, O Lord. Let's see, Debbie. Yep. Everybody got a sheet there, and it's on the screen too.
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you,
to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us purposeness for your glory. Teach us, Lord, full obedience, holy reverence, true humility. Test our thoughts and our attitudes in the radiance of your purity. Cause our faith to rise, cause our eyes to see your majestic love and authority. Words of power that can never fail, let their truth prevail over unbelief. Speak, O Lord, and renew our minds. Help us grasp the heights of your plans for us. Truths unchanged from the dawn of time that will echo down through eternity, and by grace will stand on your promises, and by faith will walk as you walk with us. Speak, O Lord, till your church is built and the earth is filled with your glory. Amen. Don't you love that song? I sure do love that song. You can take your Bibles and open to the book of Philippians, if you will. Thank you, Alice. Philippians chapter 2. Okay. And Tim, are you nice and comfortable? Because if you are, I'm going to get you up and have you hand out this sheet to everybody. Or maybe I can do it. Alice, do you have one? Huh? Yes, all right. Jump down. There you go. Uh-huh. There you go, Wanda. Ladies. Uh-huh. Oh, he's got one. Now, when I was growing up and they would walk around and hand these things out, the teacher usually would be talking as he walked and would say, there will be a test. I remember, now Judd and Jock now won't remember, and some of you may not remember. Remember the old mimeograph? And what would you do? They'd get sent to the office, get this copied off, you know, and they'd put it on there. And so you grab it and you walk back smelling that mimeograph. I don't know. It probably was bad for the brain. At any rate, we're continuing on in our Experiencing God series, and tonight we're going to talk about God's invitation to join him in his work. God's invitation to join him in his work. The Bible says in Philippians 2:13, For it is God which worketh in you, both to will and to do his good pleasure. Both to will and to do his good pleasure. Sometimes we get the idea, this is my idea, you know, this is my... I hear people talk, and I don't mean to say it this bad, that they say it this way, talk about my ministry, this and that, but it's God's will and to do his good pleasure. Let's pray tonight and ask God to speak to our hearts. Heavenly Father, we love you tonight, and we just need to confess that. Thank you so much for the truth of your word and the preservation of it. God, we understand that all that does is no good if we don't open it up. So, Father, may we, on purpose, go into your word, whether driven by reading other books and searching your scripture to see if those sayings are so, whatever, God, we pray that we might draw closer to you in our walk, that we might learn to love you more. Help me tonight, Lord, to say only those things you'd have me to say. I pray for the several people, members, dear Lord, that could be here tonight but are not for various reasons, several because of illness, some because they may be providentially hindered with work, and then others, dear Lord, we recognize may just be a heart issue. And God, we pray that we might, as a body, realize the importance of being together. We pray and ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. The part of the book of Adams, part of the book of Genesis, is the record of God accomplishing his purposes through the life of Abraham. And as you go on to that, I think it starts about chapter 12 in Abraham. And he said, get thee into a land that I'll show thee. Here you have this man from Mesopotamia, right? And he was very well-to-do and a very good businessman. And God came to him and says, well, that's all fine and dandy, but he said, I got another plan for you. Get up and go. Get up and go. That would be kind of a hard thing for many of us to do. And yet you look at what he had, all of his family members, all of his servants, all of the cattle and all that, and he did it. But as we go through that, we see those things that God is accomplishing through the life of Abraham. And you see the growth of Abraham as he's going along. But you know, that's not primarily the record, Abraham's walk with God there in the book of Genesis that we're learning about. The attention of the Bible and in that book of Genesis is always focused back onto God. Always back onto God. God created man with a free will. And guess what? His desire is for you and myself to love him. He wants us to love him. If we desire to love him, how are we going to do that? You have to walk in the Spirit. You have to walk in the Spirit. That shows you that you're loving. He said, Jesus said, if you love me, what? Keep my commandments. Keep my commandments. The child of God must determine if he or she is going to live a God-centered life. And a God-centered life is walking in the Spirit. If you're not walking in the Spirit, you're walking in the flesh. In order to love God and to join him in his work, we must come to a place where we renounce what I'm focused on. Now, I'm not saying, talking about neglecting my duties of where I work or neglecting to pay my bills, not be focused on the things, certainly focused on those things. But we need to be focused and understand that each and every one of us, Lisa, God's got a plan for your life. And it's not all about what I'm focused on, but God, what do you want me to do? Each and every one of us. Each and every one of us. God-centered living, and you can write these down if you like. You can flip that page over on the back side. I don't think I put this on your page. No, I didn't. God-centered living. There's seven things here. God-centered living is characterized by... It's a teaching time, and I think it does good a lot of times for us to take and write down in our own pen, our own hand, some of these things. So God-centered living, and here's is characterized by, number one, confidence in God. It's characterized by confidence in God. Confidence in God. This brought me back to Kevin Ellis in school. We had a young man in school, I think he was from Kentucky, wasn't he? And did not receive a very good education and had difficulty reading. And he was dyslexic, but he had difficulty. And I remember Alice went to the president of our college. It wasn't that large of a college, but said, would it be okay if I gave him his test orally? Because he had it. You know, he had it. But anyway, confidence in God. You have confidence in God. Is your confidence in God today? Secondly, number two, dependence on God. Dependence on God. We're talking about dependence on God, on His abilities and His provision. Dependence on God, on His abilities and provision. I think about as a child growing up, my dad can whip your dad. Was I the only one ever said that? My dad can whip your dad. How big is your God? Because my God is able. My God is able. Number three, a life focused on God. A life focused on God, on His activity. A life focused on God, on His activity. What's He doing around me? What is God doing around me? A life focused on God and His activity. If I'm going too quickly, let me know. Number four. Is anybody writing this down in shorthand? No, Alice. Alice knows shorthand. I took a class called NoteHand, and there's still a couple of things I remember from 50 years ago. Anyway, number four. Did they say denial of self? Denial of self. Denial of self. We're talking about God-centered living is characterized by these things. Denial of self. Number five, seeking first the kingdom of God, His righteousness. That's Matthew 6:33, I believe. Seeking first the kingdom of God, His righteousness. We somehow have gotten all the things in life, our things pushed in front of what God wants. We've turned it around, Peter. Somehow we've done that. Seeking first the kingdom of God, His righteousness. Number six, seeking God's perspective on our circumstances. Seeking God's perspective on our circumstances. I've talked a lot about this, you know, in James 1:2. Brethren, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptation. Well, what is God's perspective on that particular circumstance in my life? Rather than being angry and upset and frustrated and mad because something came into my life, it kind of wrinkled my world, step back and say, God, what's your perspective? I want to be a student to what you're trying to teach me. And then seven, holy and godly living. Holy and godly living. His word will help you to understand what holy and godly living is. And if you're walking in the Spirit, that Spirit will bear witness with you that, uh-oh, that's not right. Uh-oh, that's not right. So consider the following biblical examples of God-centered living. God-centered living. Well, the first one we're going to use is Joseph. Remember Joseph in Genesis chapter 39? What happened? Joseph had been thrown into the pit, sold into slavery by his brothers, and Potiphar got him. And then as Potiphar's going about his duties, and God blessed him because Joseph was a godly man, Potiphar's wife attempted to seduce him daily. And he resisted her bold advances. Remember? He said, how can I do this wickedness and sin against God? He knew it would be a sin against Potiphar, the owner of his owner, against the wife, but ultimately against God. And I think that helps us if we recognize when we are faced with a situation that we might sin, that we'll be sinning against God. So she tried to force herself on him, and he fled the house, grabbed his coat, and he just ran out of it, And he went to prison rather than yielding into temptation. Went to prison. Now, a lot of guys would go, you know, that's a God-centered life, He kept his focus on God rather than any of his fleshly appetites. How about, excuse me, I've got a tickle in my throat. Joshua and Caleb. When God was ready for Israel to enter into the promised land, remember what Moses did? He said, let's get these spies together, and he sent them into the land, right? And unlike 10 of the spies, Joshua and Caleb said this, and he said this in Numbers chapter 14, verses 8 through 9. Go and write that down, you can. He said, if the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it us, a land which floweth with milk and honey. Only rebel not ye against the Lord, neither fear ye the people of the land, for they are bread for us. We'll just eat them up. There's nothing to it. For us, their defense is departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Fear them not. Numbers 14, 8 through 9. See, Joshua and Caleb were willing to trust the word of God and to proceed with confidence rather than trusting in their own strength and resources. Sometimes God presents an opportunity, and we go, but we're a small church. How can we do that? I read a story about a preacher that left a work in the Los Angeles area, took a church in Canada, this is years ago, running about 10 people. He said, I knew they couldn't afford to provide for us, but I just trusting God. Felt like God was leading us that way. He said, I got up there, and he said, I was met not long after I pulled into the drive at that little parsonage. There were six men that drove up and met with him. And he said, these six men said, we are 90 miles away, and we heard you were coming, and we are excited because we believe that God has sent you up here to not only pastor this church, but to pastor over here. And he said for 2 years he did that. And he said then after 2 years, he said, a preacher friend of mine came on up and took the other work. And he said, we were able to see so many churches, so many missions start off of that. And yet it started with 10 people with a struggling work. How about King Asa? King Asa, God, in his earlier years, King Asa lived a God-centered life. And he was facing the Cushites' army in battle. And Asa said this, he said in 2 Chronicles 14:11, he said, Asa cried unto the Lord his God and said, it is nothing with thee to help. He's talking to God. Hey, it's nothing for you to help. He said, whether with many or with them that have no power, help us, O Lord, our God, for we rest on thee. I like that phrase. For we rest on thee. Do you rest on God tonight with the problems in your life, the situations? We've all got things going on. Allison and I have got something going on very close to us. We have to rest on God. Because in and of myself, I can do nothing. but God can. And he says, and in thy name we go against this multitude. That's great. O Lord, thou art our God. Let not man prevail against thee. God delivered the enemy into his hand, and the nation experienced peace. Okay, how about now 8 things. Get your pens or pencils ready. Self-centered living is characterized by. Self-centered living is characterized by. And a lot you could just take those other ones and just flip them around, the antithesis of. But self-centered living is characterized by. And if you see these, you know, and it's good to write them down, because if you see things like this, it'll be like a clue, like, uh-oh, am I focusing on myself or am I focusing on God? Number one, life is focused on self. Life focused on self. Life focused on self. Number two, pride in self and personal accomplishments. Pride in self and personal accomplishments. Judd, when I look at that, I think a lot of the professional athletes today that have a lot of pride in what they are able to do and their personal accomplishments, and yet they don't recognize that God gave them the physical ability to do those things. A lot of people in America can be successful and can kind of pat themselves on the back because of their accomplishments, not recognizing had they been born in a third world country. I was out talking with Brother Venegas here just a couple of minutes ago as they're out there playing volleyball. One of these days I get my arm fixed, you get your arms fixed, Wayne, we'll go back and play some volleyball against them. But 2 men out there, he said, you see that man? You see that man? I said, yeah. He said, they are from Ecuador. And they sought asylum here because the government was looking to kill him. Looking to kill him. Praise God. Number three, self-confidence. Self-confidence. We could have been born in Ecuador. Self-confidence. Number four, depending on self and one's own abilities. Depending on self and one's own abilities. Five, affirming self. Affirming self. A-F-F-I-R-M-I-N-G, self. Yeah, I got this. Number six, seeking to be acceptable to the world and its ways. Seeking to be acceptable to the world and its ways. Seven, looking at circumstances from a human perspective. Again, that takes us back to James 1:2. We've got to have the correct and proper point of view. I can remember as a child, you know, going to different things, and sometimes you have a crowd of people around. And you go, I can't see. And then your dad would reach down, pick you up, and hold you up nice and high. Give you a different perspective so you could see. That's what we need to look for, is God's perspective. How does God see this? And then 8, selfish and materialistic living. Selfish and materialistic living. It's about like the rich man that had so much, he said, I'm going to tear down these barns and I'm going to build new ones. For what? You know, folks, when you die, you know how much you leave? You leave it all. You leave it all. Someday somebody will be living in my house. It's not me. They may be driving that old car I drive. I don't know. We don't know. So let's consider some more examples of self-centered living. Self-centered living. Start with Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve. Think about it. God placed Adam and Eve in the most beautiful garden ever made. Ever made. In the Garden of Eden, they had everything they needed for comfort and for pleasure. God warned them not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The Bible tells us in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 14, it says, "And Adam was not deceived, but the woman being deceived fell into transgression." And we read this story in Genesis chapter 2, starting in verse 16 through Genesis 3 through verse 7. Okay. So, and then Eve shared with Adam the forbidden fruit. He ate it, and they were what? Put out of the garden. It was a self-centered decision that violated the Lord's command, and it led to a broken relationship with God. It hurt and hampered their relationship. You know, I was thinking about this. Have you ever been told something by someone, and then you go around the corner or wherever, or next day or whatever, and somebody else tells you something different, totally different, and you go, "Well, that's not what I heard." What's the best thing to do? Go back to that first person and say, "Just want to clarify, what did you say?" Here it is. It occurred to me that perhaps Eve could have said, Now that serpent was more subtle than any other beast. He was is the best at deceiving. Beautiful to look at. But she could have gone back to God and said, "God, I was talking to the serpent, and he said this." You know, that would have taken care of the whole thing. It didn't happen. How about the 10 spies? 10 spies. We talked about Caleb and Joshua. Moses sent the 12 men into Canaan to explore it and to bring back a report of the land that God had promised to Israel. The land was abundant, just as God had said it would be. But it came back and it said, "Hey, the people there, yeah, that's a bunch of good stuff. A lot of produce, and a lot of grape produce, and boy, big grapes and all this. But they're giants. They're giants. How can I overcome these giants?" We find that in Numbers 13 and 14. Joshua and Caleb were prepared to trust God, but the other spies protested and said, "But the men that went up with him said, 'We be not able to go up against the people.'" See, that's where he messed up. Should have said, "God with us, we will be able to defeat the people." And they continued and said, "For they are stronger than we." You know, rather than looking to God and his power, he focused on himself, on themselves and their weaknesses. Sometimes we are very aware of our shortcomings, our failings. "I can't do that." No, but God can. But you know what's sad? As little did they know how God had prepared the way. 40 years later, remember the story of Rahab the harlot? And she was talking. She's an inhabitant of Jericho, and she described what God had done. She explained that when the people heard about God's deliverance of Israel from Egypt, this is what she said happened. In Joshua 2:11, now this is 40 years earlier, it says, and as we had heard these things, our hearts did melt, neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and earth beneath. And I need to clarify what I said because I'm incorrect. They had 40 years of wandering because they would not go into the land. When God had already prepared the hearts of those around them, said they looked and they said, "We can't do anything against these people and their God." God had already set it up. He'd set the table. All they had to do was be obedient. But they didn't do it. Then King Asa again. King Asa, He was another battle being threatened by Baasha, king of Israel. Before, he had trusted the Lord. This time, however, instead of turning to God for help, he sent gold and silver from his temple, from the temple, from his own kingdom, and he sent it asking for help in the conflict. God was not pleased. God rebuked Asa and said, "Herein thou hast done foolishly. Therefore, from henceforth, thou shalt have wars," because he did not trust God. Trusted God one time, and then got to thinking, "I think I got this. I think I got this." You know, when you're starting to think like that, "I think I got this," you better fall on your face and say, "God, forgive me. God, direct my life. God, may I go in your power." See, self-centeredness is a subtle, it's subtle, and yet it's a very common trap. The world praises self-reliance, and trusting God to them makes no sense. Absolutely no sense. On the other hand, it makes perfect sense to Almighty God. So we need to be careful that we're not like Asa, that we trust God one time and then don't trust him another time. God-centeredness requires a daily denial of self and a submission to God. Apostle Paul said, "I die daily." In the book of John, chapter 12, in verse 25, it says, "He that loveth his life shall lose it. And he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto eternal life." You see, it's God's purposes. What is God's purpose to do? Not my plans. What is God's purpose to do? We need to try and to see things from God's perspective. Say, "God, lift me up here so I can get a little bit better look at what you're trying to do. I want to make sure that I'm following your path and your direction." We get a distorted view from our point of vision. I think a lot of churches, a lot of times, pastors may be trying to direct and lead the people a certain way, and you might have people that, I cannot see that. Well, perhaps it's pastor's inability to explain it thoroughly and properly, but sometimes that distorted view can cause that activity that God wants to do not to happen. When God starts out to do something in our world, he takes the initiative. This is what I'm going to be doing. God warned Noah when he was about to bring divine judgment on the earth through a flood, Genesis chapter 6. Remember the story? When God prepared the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, he revealed his plan to Abraham. That's Genesis chapter 18. God approached Gideon when he wanted to deliver the Israelites from the oppression of the Midianites. Judges chapter 6, verses 11 through 16. When God was preparing to send a long-awaited Savior to the earth, he told a teenage girl, Mary, in Luke chapter 1. God appeared to Saul on the road to Damascus when he was about to send the gospel message to the Gentiles around the world, in Acts chapter 9. You see the commonality in that? In every situation, each situation was not about what the individual wanted to do, but what God wanted to do. The critical factor was God and his doing. You look a little closer at the example of Noah. What if Noah said, "Oh, God, that seems pretty harsh. Tell you what, I've got a plan that I can evangelize the world. I'll go door to door. I'll go door to door and just tell everybody about you." Certainly have been a very noble thing to do, well-intended, but when it comes to the light of God's plans, it was completely irrelevant. "I don't need that, Noah. I know what I'm doing. I got this. Noah did not call on God to help him accomplish what he was dreaming of doing for God. And in Scripture, you'll never find God asking people to, okay, sometimes you're at work and the boss will call you in and say, "We've got a situation here, okay? And here's the situation, all right? I need you to come up with three ideas or three plans that we can figure out how to do this better. Well, God doesn't work that way with us. He doesn't say, hey, Peter, I want you to come up with three plans and write them down and then present them to me, and I'll choose one. No, he knows what he's doing. Remember, those in the Bible who received praise from God were not brilliant planners. They were humble. They were heroes of the faith. And we read about them in Hebrews chapter 11. God commended them for their obedience, not their performance. Their obedience, not their performance. I think a lot of preachers, a lot of time, pastors can fall into a trap. Well, the church is not running 150, 250, 500 people, whatever. Pick a number. And so they fall out of obedience with God, and they try to manipulate a performance. How do they do that? Well, you go into some churches, and they've got quite a light show going on. The music is blasting. I don't know. We need to do it God's way. God's way. God wants us to know more than just his character. He wants us also to learn his ways. In Isaiah chapter 55, verses 8 and 9, we understand that God's ways are not our ways. God's ways are not our ways. I learned that lesson from my father several times. Go do this. Okay. Go do it. He come check on it. Nope. It's not done. Well, I did it. That's not my way. That's not my way. He was teaching me the right way to do things. And he taught me that if it's not done properly, correctly, it's not done. God's ways are not our ways. We cannot know how God acts unless he teaches us. Got to remember, God is infinitely wise. God is in tomorrow for us. I mean, he's there. The future, that's just, I know what it is. He understands our world and everything that takes place in it. God wants us to align our lives with him so he will accomplish his divine purposes in and through us. If we do not submit to God in his ways, he will allow us to follow our own devices. But remember, and be sure of this, we will miss God's activity, and we will not experience what God wants to do through us to bless others. You're doing your own thing. God's got something for our life. I say the name John and Charles Wesley and George Whitfield. Does that ring a bell to anyone? John Wesley, Charles Wesley, George Whitfield, all preachers. Susanna Wesley had, I think, 17 children, of which two were John and Charles Wesley. We saw, which one, John's or Charles? Charles Wesley. We saw when we were in England. We happened into a cemetery. We said, oh, let's just go walk in there. And there was the grave of Charles Wesley. There was the sarcophagus of John Bunyan of Pilgrim's Progress. There was another sarcophagus of Isaac Watts, the great, wrote so many hymns. But anyway, I digress. When God began to speak to John and Charles Wesley, he was preparing to bring about a sweeping revival across England that would save the nation from a terrible revolution like they'd had in France, not too long before. So through the Wesleys and along with George Whitefield and some others, God was able to turn England around morally and spiritually. That's what we're praying for America. The Wesleys and Whitfield could not possibly have realized the magnitude of what God had intended to do through their lives. They just had a burden. And they got in the middle of what God was doing. And look what God did. When we look back, we see the size of what had happened spiritually. On this side, going forward, they didn't really. They were just being faithful. God's purposes throughout Scripture we see God taking the initiative in people's lives. He would encounter a person and then reveal what he desired of them. And this revelation to everybody was always an invitation for people to adjust their lives to God, not for God to adjust down to them. Sometimes we make God who we want him to be, the big guy, the man upstairs, all these things. It's not my God. He's Almighty God, Jehovah God. We need to reorient our lives to God and see his perspective. We must allow him to develop his character in us. In us. I use my father a lot as an example. People see me. Oh, you remind me of your dad. You know, the way he would stand, the way he'd hold himself, the way he'd say things. You'd always go. We need to develop God's character in us. In us. Back to Philippians 2:13. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do his good pleasure. That'd be a good verse to memorize. Good verse to memorize. If you keep your life God-centered, then you will want to participate in his activity when he reveals his plans to you. Remember the children of Israel? And they were fleeing Egypt. You know, Pharaoh said, yeah, you can go. Oh, man, he took that back so many times. And so now they get up against the Red Sea. It looked like a closed door, didn't it? It looked like a bad situation. But if you're God-centered and your focus remains on him alone, though the storms may rage around you, as long as you have God in your sight, you'll stay on course. Talk a little bit about George Mueller here real quick. George Mueller was a pastor in England during the 19th century. So that's the 1800s. No, I wasn't born then. But I did have a couple of grandparents born then. But it's 1800s. And he observed that God's people were discouraged, that most believers no longer expected God to do anything unusual in their lives or churches. Doesn't that sound like today? We should expect it. But if God worked in our life like that, most of us would probably faint because we really don't believe it. And yet God does work in our lives. They no longer trusted God to answer their prayers. In short, Christians were not living by faith at all. So Mueller began to pray that God would direct him into a ministry that could only be explained as a work of God. On a much smaller, lesser situation in my own life, I remember asking God, I want to see you work in my life. So Mueller came upon the verse in Psalm 81:10. Turn there. You need to read the words with me. Psalm 81:10. Psalm 81:10. And this is what he read. George Mueller reading, he goes, the Bible said, I am the Lord thy God, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt. Open thy mouth wide, and I will fill it. Wow. Open your mouth. You hungry? I'm the Lord your God. I'll fill it. Just open your mouth. So Mueller began to seek God's provision for his work in a way that God would be pleased to provide, as well as a result that God, and as a result, God took him on a journey of faith that became an outstanding testimony that all that would hear his story. So whenever Mueller felt God was leading him to undertake a project, he prayed for the resources needed. Now, he had 4 orphanages that would house like 2,000 children at a time. And he housed 10,000 children over the course of this orphanages. And folks, you got to realize it wasn't just a one-day stay. Okay? So it cost a lot of money. So he would pray for the resources needed, the money, whatever it's going to take. But he told no one of the need. This is one man praying. This is one man praying. Now, as it got going, people saw what God was doing. And I'm certain that they looked for opportunities to get into the middle of God's will and be a part of that. But he would pray for the God to supply the need. He didn't want this to be publish it out there and then have somebody do fundraising for him. He wanted God to do something miraculous, and he wanted to be witness to that miraculous thing that God was doing. During his ministry in Bristol, he started, it's called the Scriptural Knowledge Institute for the Distribution of Scripture and for Religious Education. That's a mouthful. And then he also established orphanages. At the time of George Mueller's death, he built four orphanages and cared for all those children that I told you. He died at 93, and he had $800 worth of value in his life. And yet he had raised, through prayer, $8 million. Now, to put that in perspective, I had Alice drive in tonight, which is an abnormal thing. I was looking at some things on my phone and on my laptop. You know how much that $8 million would be worth today? About $300 million. That one man prayed, and God blessed. God met the need. George Mueller testified, "I never remember a period that I ever sincerely and patiently sought to know the will of God and the teaching of the Holy Spirit through the instrumentality of the Word, but I have always been always directly righted." He said, "But if honesty of heart and uprightness before God were lacking, or if I did not patiently wait upon God for instruction, or if I preferred the counsel of my fellow man," hey, George, I've got an idea. This might work for you. "To the declarations of the Word of the living God," he said, "I made great mistakes." What helped George Mueller to know his will? I'll read these things, and then I've got in your paper what he said. He sincerely sought God's direction. He waited patiently until he had a word from God in the Scriptures. He looked to the Holy Spirit to teach him through God's Word. When he was making mistakes, what did he do? He lacked honesty in his own heart. He lacked uprightness before God. He wasn't walking as he should. George Mueller? Yeah. He was impatient about waiting for God. God's never in a hurry. He's never late. And if he preferred the counsel of men over Scripture. And then I'll read this with you. Here is how George Mueller summed up the way to a heart relationship with God. He said, "I seek at the beginning to get my heart into such a state that it has no will of its own in regard to a given matter." Boy, most of the time when we fall on our faces before God, we know where we want to end up. We know where we want to wind up. God, here's my problem. This is where I want to get to. We don't say it out loud. God knows our heart, and we don't recognize it. He continued, he said, 9/10 of the trouble, or 90% of the trouble with people generally, is just there. 9/10 of the difficulties are overcome when our hearts are ready to do the knowledge of what his will is. Secondly, he says, having done this, I do not leave the result to feeling or simple impression. If so, I make myself liable to great delusions. Thirdly, I seek the will of the Spirit of God through or in connection with the Word of God. This next sentence is outstanding. He says, the Spirit and the Word must be combined. They bear witness against one another, with one another. He said, if I look to the Spirit alone without the Word, I lay myself open to heart delusions also. I think that's supposed to be heart. I said heat. If the Holy Spirit guides us at all, he will do it according to the Scriptures and never contrary to them. And they said, next, I take into account providential circumstances. These often plainly indicate God's will in connection with His Word and Spirit. The illustration, the little story I told you earlier in the message about the man that left Los Angeles and went to Canada. He got up there, and God brought some men over because He had a plan. Fifthly, he said, I asked God in prayer to reveal His will to me aright. And then six, he says, thus through prayer to God, the study of the Word and reflection, I come to a deliberate judgment according to the best of my ability and knowledge. And if my mind is thus at peace and continues so after two or three more prayers, I proceed accordingly. I pray about it, and God has left peace on my heart. I go with it. So your love relationship with God prepares you to be involved in His work by developing you in a God-centered life. Focusing your attention on God's plans, on His purposes, and on His ways rather than your ways. God Himself is the one who initiates your involvement in His work. Hey, Dwayne, come here. I got here this morning, Dwayne said, man, we had visitors in the church. Some people broke in the door over there. Doesn't look like they took anything. Got here tonight, Dwayne said, come here. Got over there, he says, they won't get in now. He fixed it. God had him working and doing some things. God does not ask you to dream something up that you can do for Him. He initiates what He wants us to be involved in. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for the time together tonight. Thank you for this group that has joined together. I pray, God, that you bless them. I pray for the ones that were not here, that you'd bless them as well, dear God. Ask that your Holy Spirit would convict those that could be here but just decided church wasn't for them tonight. Dear God, we pray that we would allow you to be the center of our heart, our will, and our walk and our ways. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you very much. You're dismissed.